Thank you, Mr. Vijay Chandran, for that very generous welcome to all of us. Professor Mammo, Muchie, our distinguished guest today, Dr. Rangel Kumar, Mr. Raj Kumar, who is the chairman of the Institution of Engineers, is also my student. I should remember his name better. Other distinguished guests and friends. This is a nostalgic moment for me to chair a lecture on Africa. One keeps talking about various countries of the world. We always talk about Pakistan and China, who are not our best friends. But it's rarely that we celebrate our relationship with Africa. Because of various reasons, I think we probably take Africa for granted. They have been our friends for centuries. But it is very important for us to know what is happening in Africa today. I am myself a little bit outdated. I served in Africa between 95 and 97 in Kenya, in this beautiful capital of Nairobi. But my time also goes back to the days when I was at the United Nations, struggling for two states in Africa. One was South Africa and the other was Namibia. As you perhaps know, it was India which raised the question of apartheid for the first time in the United Nations. And at that time we were criticized for bringing in internal issues of other countries to the UN. But you know, by 1994 that changed. The whole world fought for the freedom of the people of South Africa. And you know the important role that we played. And going back to the days of Mahatma Gandhi, who actually sharpened his instrument of struggle in South Africa. So it's a long story, but there is even a story that Africa was part of India geographically many, many centuries ago, and it just broke off because of some kind of an earthquake or something. So that's what explains the kind of linkage that we have with Africa. And speaking of my own experience, I must say that of all the continents that I have served in and all the countries that I have been to, it is in Africa that one felt so much close to the soil of Africa, because there is so much that we have in common, and also of our history of a colonial past, we had so many things to share. And also in education, at one time we could count at least about five or six heads of state in Africa who were educated in India. Even today we have African students all over the country, and every year we used to meet the officials of the Kenyan government who had studied in India, and they had many memorable things to tell us. More recently, the Asians, as they are called, many Indians are living in Africa and contributing to its growth, and that is another bond that we have. In fact, there are so many Patels in Africa that people used to wonder where they came from. In fact, there is this story about a man who was walking on Nairobi street, and he was looking at the nameplates, and every nameplate was K. Patel, P. S. Patel, U. R. Patel, I. M. Patel, etc., etc. So then he asked his friend, where do these Patels come from? And then he walked further and found a big board, Patel Manufacturing Company. So he said, now I know where these Patels come from. So we even have Patel Manufacturing Company in Nairobi. So it's a very intricate, very complex, very pleasant relationship that we have in Africa. And in our participation in the development of Africa, we were very careful that we looked at the needs of Africa and the technology that was relevant to Africa, that was much more relevant to Africa than the very many technologies that came from Japan and Korea and now from China. So initially, if a country has contributed to Africa's growth, it is basically India. But later we had to compete with the Japanese and the Koreans first, because whenever we offered projects to Kenya, for example, they always found a more flashy project from from Japan or Korea. And also our terms of our experience or our cooperation with Africa was always linked with the kind of SMEs, that are small and medium scale industries which are relevant to Africa. And also we expected the Africans to cooperate in that rather than give them free gifts. We were more interested in having cooperation and cooperative effort. So some of this went to our disadvantage in Africa, particularly when the Chinese came in with their silver bullet diplomacy, with a lot of money and checks and so on. And so we have lost out in Africa recently. In fact, many countries, China has taken over the kind of relationship we had with Africa. But I think Africa is now realizing the difference between India's cooperation and Chinese influence in Africa, because Africa has been, China has been exploiting Africa, taking away the minerals, taking away their wealthy resources, and of course giving them flashy stadia and factories and so on. So there is a change already taking place after a few years of disadvantage for India. Now I think many African countries are realizing that the Chinese are not there like the Indians were there to serve Africa but to exploit them. And therefore there is a kind of return to India. Recently, you may know that the Prime Minister had hosted a summit meeting of African leaders, and almost all of them came to Delhi. Of course, they had all gone to Beijing a year earlier, but when our Prime Minister invited them, they also came, and we had a very new experience. We have opened up new credit lines to Africa, and very many interesting projects have now come up in our relationship with India. So I do not know what he is going to talk about, but I'm sure with his rich experience of very many African countries and also his knowledge of India, we will certainly benefit from this experience. And I'm very grateful to CISA for asking me to be here with a sense of nostalgia and sense of a feeling of pride that we do share a historic past with Africa. And it is growing, and we continue to maintain interest. So many of you are here, obviously, to show that people in Trivandrum have interest in Africa, and that is something which is very, very encouraging. So like you, I look forward to his talk and to update myself on the African situation. Thank you very much.